to Sunday morning worship via Zoom for Kitimat First Baptist Church here in beautiful, I'm going to call it beautiful, Kitimat, British Columbia, where it continues to rain. We're getting used to that wetness over top of our snow. For those of you who are here today, thank you so much for being a part of this. And for those of you who will be watching this later on social media, on some kind of video, maybe on our Facebook page or maybe on our YouTube channel, you are welcome too. We put this worship service online, whether we are meeting together physically or not, because we want the gospel to go out into the world and to be able to be received by whoever can receive it and receive the blessing that comes in hearing the word of God and knowing that God is for you. So welcome here. This is a wonderful time for us to be together, and we feel very blessed to have you here. We'll be continuing with the material that the Canadian Baptists of Western Canada, of which we are a part, have provided us. They call this 7-week prayer initiative, Orienting to God. And we'll be doing week 2 of that. So there'll be a portion of time during our worship where we will have directed prayer. It's a time where we are supposed to pray corporately. Unfortunately, Zoom doesn't handle that well. If everybody turns their microphone on and everybody speaks at the same time, it's a real cacophony and a little hard to handle. So I'm going to strongly urge you to pray out loud at home with your microphones off when we get to that time. I'll be helping lead us through that. But please do that. And let's encourage one another by committing to do that so that we know our voices are being lifted up in unison, just like they're being lifted up in unison in Canadian Baptists of Western Canada churches all over BC and the Yukon. That's our particular part of the group, although we have churches that will be doing this in Alberta and Saskatchewan and Manitoba. So many, many churches involved in this prayer initiative. Before we go to our time of musical worship, I want to say a short prayer of invocation, and then please feel free to sing to your heart's content. I want to particularly thank Calvin and some of the other folks at in our worship group, because I was getting dry with ideas about what we could possibly sing anymore. It's not really, I know I play in our worship group and everything, but sometimes I'm not the most creative person when it comes to that. So they made some wonderful suggestions for worship songs we haven't sung in a while, and I'm excited to be able to share them with you this morning and to also experience them myself. Dear friends, let us take a moment, orient ourselves to God, come away from our day-to-day into this time that we make holy by offering it to the Holy Father we know. Let us pray. Almighty, most gracious, most holy, most majestic, living God, we come to you from different experiences and some shared experiences. We all are under the press of the medical emergency in British Columbia and right across the world. We come to you from the pressures and the frustrations and the difficulties of having to live under those strictures. We come to you because there are changes taking place in our lives. We come to you to step away from those things and know your constance, your constant care, love, overarching provision for us. help us to take this time to slow down, come fully into your presence, be filled with the presence of your spirit that connects us. Even though we can't physically be in the same room with each other, we are connected on a level that cannot be broken, because we are connected in Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. Extend your power, Spirit, so that there is worship happening in each and every place, each and every home represented here, that each person and their extended family are coming into a gracious moment and time with you. Father, we pray that as we go into this time of worship, you will be lifted up, high and lifted up in each of our lives, high and lifted up in each of our families, high and lifted up before our friends and those that we work with, so that our witness will go forward as well. Thank you, Father. Thank you for gathering us. Thank you for directing us. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Each day, each stand. colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable. Awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who'd imagine the sun and give source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable. Awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable. Awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God.
Became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners. Messiah.
Let us begin, friends. Almighty Heavenly Father, we praise your name today in every way that we can think of, and even then we know our praises fall far short of what you are worthy. But you say to us, it is enough that we come and acknowledge you. It is enough that we say you are God. It is enough that we say we are your people. Thank you for your graciousness to us, Lord. It is astoundingly, astoundingly beautiful. Father, you give us what we need every day. We know that, and we are well cared for. But you know there's always special instances. There's always something in the present context that you say we should bring to you in joy or in entreating, in however we can. And so, Father, I bring to you this glorious news that Brad is finally able to have an improvement to his employment situation. It has been certainly a long-term prayer on his part, and you have answered it well, better than could be imagined. And we praise you for that. We thank you for that. We are just so overjoyed for our brother, And we know, Father, that you will use Brad in his new way of working to continue to be a strong witness to the gospel in Kitimat and among the people of Kitimat. And we thank you for that. And we are just, again, we praise you, we thank you, we adore you for your giving. Father, little Kylie, as mentioned by Leota, is in need of seeing special doctors. And we think of Quinn as well. There are others who are in need of medical care, and we know that medical care isn't the only answer, but it's part of the answer you provide. And so we don't deny it, we don't turn away from it, but we ask you, Father, to infuse all the medical care we receive, every one of us receive, infuse it with your power and wisdom and strength and truth. And may we remember that we should be confessing to one another so that we may be healed, as it says in the letter from James, the brother of Jesus. May we take advantage of that. May we trust you at your word and go to brothers and sisters who can help us bear our load and see us healed through confession and through reconciliation. Father, you continue to give us everything that we need. You continue to watch over us and give us all that we require. Father, may your grace continue to flow through the members of this church to provide what is required for continuing the ministries of this church. I know we aren't using the building as we had hoped to, but we remain confident, Lord, that you desire that we refrain from enjoying that while others cannot be with us, that we continue to stand for the inclusion of all, regardless. And we continue to implore you, Lord, that you will speak to the hearts of those who govern to show them that they need not fear what so many fear, that they need not cower and continue to cause us to be held underneath these strictures, underneath these orders, that it's time for us to be able to make decisions for ourselves and to live with respect and love and care for one another. Lord, we are not free because others are not free, and you tell us that we are to suffer with those who are suffering. And so we do. And we do so for your glory, Lord, not to make ourselves seem better or more righteous. It is just what you would have us do, to stand with those who are feeling the oppression and to say, we identify with you and we are with you because of the love Christ had to be with us and identify with us. We continue in prayer, Lord, as we follow what the Canadian Baptists have provided for us in this orienting to God. And so help us, Lord, as we move through this together, help us to receive from them the teaching that they have provided and receive from you the blessing that continues in this prayer. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Thank you.
The very first phrase in the Lord's Prayer orients us toward both God and community. Jesus teaches us to pray, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name," or as in other translations, "Make your name holy."
Beginning with "our" reminds us this is a corporate prayer. It is God's people in His church praying with the church. Praying with the church means praying the same things together, which is different than praying in the church, where we pray for individuals and our own individual needs using our own words.
"Our" reminds us that prayer is about relationships. God to humans, humans to one another, and humans to creation itself.
"Our" places us immediately into a posture of prayer that is kingdom-oriented. It launches us back into the meaning of the Shema, which Jesus would have prayed daily, and which He proclaimed as the greatest of all the commandments. "Love the Lord your God with all our heart, mind, soul, strength," and to which Jesus added, "love our neighbors as ourselves."
We pray "Father in heaven" to state we pray not to unknown gods or even a distant God, but to God who is close at hand, who is near and all around us. He is our Father who knows us intimately, and we are His beloved children. Praying "Our Father in heaven, make your name holy" also reminds us that we were created to glorify God. We are His image bearers, made in the likeness of the Holy One.
We were created to reflect God's character to one another and to the world. We make God's name holy when we act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly as servants to others, laying down our lives for the sake of the other. As we orient ourselves to God through these words to our Father, we pray together with the church.
Please pray out loud in your own homes when you see the instruction for all to pray. Our Father in heaven, make your name holy. As we pray collectively, we pray your Spirit would draw all people to yourself so that the world may know you as our Father. We come with grateful hearts that you call us yours, and we can call you ours. We belong to you, and we belong to one another, your beloved children. We pause now to offer our gratitude to God, who is our Father. Our Father, we pray that you would teach us to love you with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our soul, and with all our strength. Transform us to increasingly reflect you in our fragmented and hurting world. We ask you to pour upon us your spirit of wisdom and revelation as we join your work in the world of bringing all things in heaven and earth together under Christ. May we make your name holy as we reflect you by acting justly, loving mercy, and walking humbly with you. Our God and Father, may you be honored by the way we live. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Friends, this brings us now to our time of teaching. And I'll turn my video on, and hopefully that won't be too distracting for you. So some time ago, I think I told you that I had asked God what I could preach, and I felt really compelled to preach one of the Gospels. And part of me is going, yippee, get to preach the Gospel. Oh, please let it be John. And God said, no, I don't think we're going to do John, Brian. And I said, well, Luke? And he goes, no, I don't think we're going to do Luke. And I go, well, okay, Mark then. And the reason Matthew came up last in my mind, sadly, is because it's probably the longest one next to Luke. And it's full of really difficult moments for most people who are Christians, because it's got more words from Jesus than any other of the Gospels. And that means we hear everything that Jesus has to say, and not just the bits we like to hear. But I'm excited for this. I feel deeply, deeply blessed to be able to bring this Gospel to us over the coming weeks, and it will take months. It may even take more than a year to get through this. There's a lot here. 3 years of Jesus' life documented very, very well by one of his own disciples. And so I want to talk a little bit about orienting ourselves to this gospel over the next until we're done with it. And we will do the same things, by the way, my dear friends, as we've done in the past. I will take time aside for Lent and Easter. We will take time aside in the summer to read Psalms and to do other things because of the fact that we aren't together following the same thread. And we will always take time for Advent and Christmas. So there will be moments of stepping away from the text in Matthew and then going back to it again. But I pray that you are as excited for this journey as I am. And I'm praying that God will use this time in all of us to deepen our discipleship, deepen our love for Christ, and deepen our understanding of his work in the world. This is the very first line from the Gospel of Matthew, and just to let you know, I will be using the English Standard Version as the primary text for this going through. I will probably from time to time choose a different translation or compare a different translation, just because there are nuances that no single English translation can fully capture. But the ESV gets very close to being word for word, and that makes it very, very useful for us when we want to dig deep into God's word. So this is how Matthew started it. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And that's a very, very loaded sentence. It connects his gospel directly to the Old Testament. It shows that Jesus is the promised Messiah. Hence, he calls him Jesus the Christ, which is the same as saying Jesus the Messiah. It connects him directly to the Davidic kingdom and the Davidic line, which he was promised to come from, and it connects him directly to Abraham and the covenants of God made with all of the peoples through all of redemptive history. And in this one line, I think Matthew does a masterful job of telling his readers what he is intending to present to them in the subsequent passages. It's pretty obvious that it was written for the Jews, and we see here that that's where he's going. Now, I could talk a lot about textual differences. I could get into all the academic stuff that gets argued about when this was written and was it really written by Matthew and who this Matthew really was and all the other stuff that goes on. But I'm going to give you this as the basis for how I approach presenting the Bible to you and how I even approach it myself. And I owe the kernel of this idea to Professor Jerry Shepherd, who said something very much like this in one of my Old Testament classes with him, and I've tried to make it my own. So when it comes to the Bible, this is what I say about it. The text we have is the text we have received. If God has not preserved it, it cannot be his word. And if it is not his word, he has not spoken. And if he has not spoken, nothing matters. My first act of faith is to receive the text as it has come to me. And that's what I believe every Christian must do. It's our first act of faith to know that Christ has spoken, God has spoken, Father, Son, Holy Spirit have all spoken, and spoken through the text we have received. Moreover, if it was impossible for God to bring the text unaltered in meaning and content to us, then he is not God. I was in a conversation with another person online just a few days ago, and they were making the case for our faith being a reasonable faith, a faith of thought and reason and even logic. And I said, that's good, but that's not where Christians begin, nor is it the final place we reside. And so he said, well, if it's not reason, what is our faith grounded on? And it's true. This is, it's grounded on one thing, my friends. It's grounded on witness. We have received testimony. It is a mediated faith. No one is born knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. No one is born knowing for certain that there is a Father God, a Holy Spirit. We may have inklings of this in the nature of the way that we are made and what we see around us in what's called general revelation. But that's not sufficient to bring us into an understanding of our position as sinners in the world, the brokenness of creation, and the necessity for a Savior. That is where the Word comes in as the primary witness, the special witness, if you would, the special revelation that introduces us to God, the creative Father, God, the Holy Son, who gives his life for all, for the recreation of the world, and God, the Holy Spirit, who empowers us, God, everything, and makes it all work together. So this is where we begin. I will tell you what we do know about Matthew that I can say with any confidence. Matthew is Levi and Levi is Matthew. It depends on which of the Gospels you look at. He is referred to by both names, but it's eminently and evidently clear that he is the same person. He is called Levi in the description of his call in Mark's Gospel. Mark's Gospel actually being Peter's Gospel, written for him by his personal scribe and disciple, Mark. Also written in the calling of Matthew, he's called Levi in Luke, but he's also called Matthew in the lists of the disciples. And so we know Matthew is Matthew, and there is no doubt about that. And we know that Matthew is a tax collector, was a tax collector. He was a Jew. He was also a tax collector, and that made him a very unpopular Jew. long before he associated with an upstart rabbi from Nazareth, there wasn't a Jew anywhere in the land of Israel, in the land of Judah in the south and Israel in the north, who would have had any time of day for him. But it did mean he had certain skills. It meant that he had the ability to write, the ability to read, and the ability to keep records. This would be very, very important when it came to doing what he did, which is write down his gospel. So he was a despised Jew before Christ was a despised Jew. And he wasn't just despised by the Jews. The Romans weren't particularly kind or disposed towards their Jewish tax collectors. They used them because they were useful to them. It allowed them to collect taxes from the Jews, who were a particularly rambunctious bunch who didn't want to really knuckle under the Roman rule. But the Romans were eminently practical about these things, and they knew that if they could get their taxes without shedding a great deal of blood, it was good for business. And so this is why someone like Matthew would have been seen as a despised collaborator, because it was through the work of himself and the other tax collectors that Rome received funds to continue to pay for their army and keep all of Israel and Jerusalem particularly under their thumb. Is this a good physical representation of what Matthew might have looked like? I expect so. Tax collectors would not have been young men. They would have been at least over 30, like Jesus. They would have had some level of social standing culturally amongst the Jews, so they wouldn't have been just considered kids. And they would have, in all likelihood, maintained their Jewish kosher status to the best of their ability. Now, I can't imagine what it would be like trying to go to the market and buy food from people who hate you, or to buy things for yourself from people who hate you, regardless of how much money you have. I couldn't imagine what it would be like to go down to Save On Foods every single day and try to get bread and meat from people who utterly despise you. But business is business, and that is, I expect, what Matthew's life was. Matthew did have a circle of acquaintances, because when, and we will get to this because we'll go over it, but I'll give you some foreshadowing. When he's called by Jesus, Matthew has wealth and means, and he has a large banquet for Jesus in his home, wherein many tax collectors and other undesirables attend. And it is at this meal that the Pharisees start clucking their tongues and pointing at Jesus and go, "What are you doing associating with these terrible, terrible reprobates who have no place in good, clean Jewish society?" And Jesus, this is where Jesus famously says, "I did not come for the healthy, I came for those who need a healer." So this is Matthew. Matthew called by Jesus. Matthew, who left his place as a tax collector and followed him as a disciple. And it becomes evident as we go through his gospel that he is a Jew writing to the Jews. He is presenting Jesus, he is presenting the gospel in a manner that speaks very directly and poignantly to the Jews. So there'll be a lot of times during our going through this gospel where we will have to check our modern view of things, where we're going to have to try to get to understand more of the context that it was written in and the people it was written to. Not because we can't understand the deep truth and meaning of it, but because the way the language works, we will be able to see deeper into the depths of truth that Matthew presents in his gospel. We will have to go to school a little bit in this process, but it will be beneficial in the long run, and it will show, very importantly, how the New Testament is a pure extension of the Old Testament, how it connects directly and completely with what Jesus would have referred to as the Holy Scriptures, and continues that message on into the new covenant that Jesus creates by his death and resurrection. As I said before, Matthew's gospel contains more sayings of Christ than any of the others. If you have a red letter Bible, I'm not opposed to those things, you'll notice that there's a lot of red in Matthew's gospel. And that's because some of the longest pieces of direct teaching appear uninterrupted in this gospel. We have the Sermon on the Mount. We have the parables of the kingdom. There's a lot of pieces that we are going to go through where it's going to be a lot of Jesus speaking and a lot of us listening to and then interpreting that and bringing it into our lives. It's also one of the other reasons why I am very excited to be sharing this gospel, because a lot of what's been happening, I think, in the popular culture about Jesus is they have been hearing his words, but they have not been given context. And unfortunately, however the church has managed to do this, we've managed to enshrine certain phrases that Jesus said because they're easy to remember. They hang nicely in the mind, but without the context, they lose their power and their ability to transform. And it is my great prayer, my deep and profound prayer, that we will be drawn back into the context of what Jesus says, why he says it the way he says it, and what that means for us today in the 21st century. See, these are some of the main themes that we're going to explore, and I want you to think and pray about these. And I also want to encourage you to start reading Matthew for yourselves. And I think the best thing to do is get a chapter or so into your mind. Don't have to go too far ahead, but start reading through and start looking for these themes as you begin reading through. There are others that we'll bring up, but these are some of the main ones that I know we'll be covering. First of all, the whole concept of the Messiah. It is vitally important to Matthew that Jesus be presented in every possible way as the promised Messiah of prophecy. And there are extensive references all through the gospel that place Jesus precisely in that position. It starts with what we'll be discussing next week, which is the genealogy of Jesus, how he came through the line to be who he was, where he was, when he was. And that's a very profound beginning for all of this. But it continues through the rest of the gospel to the very end. It is critical for Matthew that he communicate to his readers that Jesus is the Messiah. Not only is he the Messiah, he is the only Messiah they are to expect. He is the only one who could possibly be the Messiah. He is the only one who answers each and every prophecy of the Messiah. And that's why his gospel is particularly pointed at first century Jews. That doesn't mean it has nothing to say to us, but it is grounded in the answer to the longest standing question that the Jews had, and the question that's raised in all of the redemptive history of the Bible: what is God's ultimate plan for us? The next is the kingdom. The word the kingdom, words the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom, are used in Matthew probably more than anywhere else in all of the gospels. And that is because Matthew is very sensitive to this idea of the kingdom, of things being very much different under Jesus than they have ever been in the past, but that they're also a fulfillment of a desire for the way things should always have been. And as we see in redemptive history, Israel suffers under their kings, despite the fact that they want them. They reject the true king, God, and they follow human kings. And even though David is a fantastic king, he still fails. So Jesus's presentation of the kingdom of heaven and of our part in it, our adoption into it, our grafting into it, and of his position not only as the soon to be reigning king, but also being a subject to the Father himself, is a huge motif that will repeat itself over and over again as we go through this gospel. Lastly, and not leastly, and probably not the only one, the mission. The mission is a subtext that runs through the entire gospel. The mission of Christ, fulfilling the mission of God, and passing on the mission to the church until the final full consummation of the mission when Christ returns. So those are three major themes that I want you to be aware of as you begin reading Matthew and contemplating it more deeply. Ultimately, we are presenting ourselves to the gospel, and the gospel is presenting Christ to us. We read the text works in us. God's word is unlike any other human writing in all of history. It is preserved by the Holy Spirit, powered by the Holy Spirit, filled with truth, and it has remained unchanged. We have lots of physical evidence for this, probably the most powerful being that before they found the scrolls in Qumran in the 1940s, just after the Second World War, this Qumran is by the Dead Sea, the oldest copy of the book of Isaiah was only about 1,000 years old. It was from around the 10th century, and it wasn't even a scroll. It was a codex. That's a book with a binding. And they found an Isaiah scroll in copper at Qumran that was a full 1,000 years older. And when they finally unrolled it and translated it, it was as close to identical as it's possible for humans to do. The differences were so minuscule between the two copies that they were obvious what they were, which were slight variations in the location of certain, of just a minusculely small number of Hebrew letters. There is no other writing in all of human history, in any place, that can show the preservation of a text over that period of time simply being preserved by being copied and copied and copied by human hand. It's not possible. But with God, all things are possible. And the most important thing that we're going to receive over the next weeks and months is the gospel. Because it is the gospel that is the foundation of our worldview, is the foundation of our life, and is the foundation of our hope for the future, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Matthew contains one of the richest repositories that we know of, that presents the gospel of Jesus Christ to us in a way that we can receive it and learn from it and grow with it and be transformed by it. So, whether you've read the gospel all the way through in the past, or whether you think you know the gospel completely, I expect that even I am going to have moments in the next coming weeks and months where I'm going to go, I hadn't noticed that before. My prayer is that God will bring so much forward out of this, that together we will grow in a deeper understanding of the gospel, and through that be able to present it to our friends, to our families, to the people of Kitimat, to the people of BC, and to the world in a way that is exciting and engaging and beautiful. Please join me in prayers for that, as we continue through our study in the coming weeks. Now, I'm going to play one last song for us and remind you that there's an opportunity for us to go into that material from the Canadian Baptists a bit deeper this Wednesday. I think it's a really, really good exercise in getting us to understand how the Lord's Prayer works with us corporately. And I'm excited for what God is going to be doing in our midst in the coming weeks and months ahead. So let's have one final time of music together, and then I will give you a nice benediction, and we'll be on to the rest of our day in the Lord.
Let's go. so I won't be ashamed. Clothe me in white, so I won't be ashamed. Lord, light the fire again.
Dear friends, let me say this. May the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his everlasting peace. Go in that peace, spread it to all around you. Go in the peace of the Lord. Shalom.